benediction, but
be able to sit after the benediction and listen to the praise band sing that song. As now, as you turn to page 94 in the front of the red worship book in your pew, to the order of confession and forgiveness, and I invite those who can do so without difficulty to please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of God. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved your neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us now begin our worship with the singing of hymn number 807, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, in the back of your worship book. Hymn number 807, in the back of red worship
book. Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. I'm your announcer, your videographer. I'm your announcer, Dr. Sally Abbott. The videographer is Dr. James Pompousis. We're filling in for Linda Fox, who's working on the Mass Walk this weekend. This is Sunday, September 25th, 19th Sunday after Pentecost. We're singing a song, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. It was written by Robert Robinson, Methodist minister, 1758 in England. Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. 25th Sunday after Pentecost.
and the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. But as for you, man of God, shun all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession. I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, King of kings and Lord of lords, is he alone who has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty, or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
praise band is singing the anthem under the direction of Vicky Perks.
Satisfied
it is possible to obtain higher education and to climb the ladder of success. Now, all liberal society would applaud. And as a church, we applaud people wanting a higher education and to be successful. And we want people to be able to have a roof over their head and food on their table. But what we caution about, or what the church cautions about, is making those things your sole aim in life. Making those what Paul Tiller called the ultimate concern of your life. For as we examine our second reading for today, that sixth chapter of St. Paul's first letter to Timothy, we see St. Paul warning Timothy about just such matters. In the verse above the three we will examine in verse 10, he says, words that are very popular that we hear repeated all the time, although oftentimes repeated incorrectly. Usually what we hear is, money is the root of all evil, but that's not what St. Paul says. As you look at verse 10, he says, for the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. So St. Paul is telling Timothy that as a leader, in the community of faith, he should make sure that he inspires his congregation to aim for the true aims of life, for the greater things in life, and that is more than having that love for money. As he points out, the love of money causes all kinds of evil. And when we look back at the history of our nation, or if we just pick up the daily newspaper, we see where people having the love of money have gotten themselves into all kinds of trouble or committed criminal acts or even gone as far as to harm others in order to obtain more money. So what should be the aim of life of we in the community of faith? The first aim, St. Paul tells us, is to seek the highest values in life. And that he expresses in verse 11. And for those of you who may not have been here before, I'm reading out of the English Standard Version. The version in your insert is the New Revised, so the wording will be a little different. But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. What things? The love of money, the love of the things of the world. Flee these things, pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, and gentleness. So these are the highest values, to flee from the things of the world and to seek these values demonstrated and lived out by our Lord Jesus Christ. The word flee, the word literally means to run away from something, to escape it, or escape its clutches, to shun it. And as he writes this, it means it's a continuous action. It's something you're going to have to do each and every day of your life. And just don't say, okay, love and money, get behind me, and that's it. Because every day, Satan's going to find a way to come and tempt you into having that love of money as your top priority. Or the love of things. Or the love of fame. Or the love of power. Or the love of celebrity status. There's all kinds of things that can become our God if we're not careful. And so he's saying, flee from this. You totally run away from it, you totally escape from it, you shun it each and every day. The word pursue then means to follow after something. It's the exact opposite of that. When you're running away from the things of the world, shunning the things of the world, you want to follow after the values of Jesus Christ. You want to follow after the values of God, our Father. And so when you follow after it, it means to run after it. It means to seek it eagerly, to seek it with every bit of your body, your fiber, your strength, everything. You endeavor to acquire it. Now most people would translate that into trying to gain material treasure. But St. Paul is using it that we acquire And so this is what we want to pursue. And then we pursue righteousness. Now usually, or most often, when St. Paul uses the word righteousness, he's talking about our status before God because of our faith in Jesus Christ. Without Jesus Christ, you cannot be righteous. You have to be righteous to enter the kingdom of heaven. So you're not going to earn salvation on your own. You're not going to earn righteousness on your own. It only comes through believing in the death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. It only comes by your sinfulness being washed in the blood of the Lamb. That makes you just. Nothing you've done, Christ has done it all for you. But in this case, it means more than just our standing before God. It means to fulfill our responsibility to God and humanity. And what is our responsibility to God and humanity? What did Jesus tell us? When questioned by the young man, what was the greatest commandment? Jesus said, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, and all your mind, and the second is love him, love your neighbor as yourself. So this is our responsibility. God loves us first. God loves us so much, he sent his only son to die for us, to pay the debt of sin that we owe, so that we might have salvation. And so we respond by putting him first, by making him our top aim in life, seeking that highest value. What does the small catechism say in its explanation of the first commandment? I am the Lord your God, you shall know the gods before me. We should fear, love, and trust God above all things. And that's the key here, to fear, love, and trust God above all things. Of everything, your job, family, nation, desires, whatever, God is first. Then we have a responsibility to our neighbor. To recognize that every human being was created in the image of God, and that every human being is a child of God. Now, what has history shown us throughout the ages? That when a country goes to war with another country, the first thing you do is dehumanize your enemy. To try to present your enemy as inferior to you. To try to present the enemy as not really part of the human race. It's the same thing that happens in societies where there is prejudice or hatred. The people that prejudice or hatred is directed toward is people who you consider less than you, and you consider them less than you so that you can feel better about yourself. So the highest value is to do away with that kind of thinking and that kind of action, and instead to remember that all people are children of God. And as we learned last week from St. Peter in the second letter, it's God's desire, that's often ignored, but it's God's desire that all people be saved. God doesn't want anybody to go to hell. God doesn't send anybody to hell. We send ourselves by refusing his gracious gift through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. And so we are to love our neighbor as ourselves. And then, as a community of faith, what did Jesus tell us on the night of his betrayal? In that 13th chapter of the Gospel of John. After he had washed the disciples' feet, after he had instituted what we call the Lord's Supper, or the sacrament of the altar, as he was giving them the final instructions before they would go over to the Garden of Gethsemane and he would be betrayed, he said, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. In other words, a Christian community is supposed to be made up of brothers and sisters in Christ who have that same sacrificial love, that same giving love of Jesus Christ towards one another that Christ has towards us. That's the highest value. He also says we are to have steadfastness. The word steadfastness means endurance. It means to be constant. It means to have patience. It means to remain under trials in a God-honoring manner. In other words, if people are persecuting you, if people are putting you down, if people are being mean to you, you act in a God-honoring manner. You don't seek revenge. You don't be nasty.
but you follow the example of Jesus. What did Jesus do that first Good Friday? After they drove those spikes into his body, and they raised him up on that cross, his very first words were, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." When Stephen, the first martyr, is being stoned to death, and Saul the Pharisee is sitting there condoning his stoning and overseeing him, the same Saul would later become Paul the Apostle. See, St. Stephen said, looked up at him and said, "Father, forgive him." And so, steadfastness is to remain in the faith, to endure, to be patient, even under trial, even under persecution. And then the word gentleness, also translated as meekness. This means, doesn't mean just being real kind of shy and soft-spoken and curling up in a corner as somebody being mean to. The word literally means the spirit of accepting God's dealing with you as good. Therefore, you do not dispute God or resist him. Probably not what you were thinking the example of the definition of meekness would be. It is to have the spirit of accepting God's dealing with you and accepting it as being good, and therefore not disputing what he has to be or resisting. Remember old Jonah? Prophet in the Old Testament, God comes in and says, "Jonah, pack it up, head east. I want you to go to the city of Nineveh. And I want you to repeat a message of repentance so that the city might have an opportunity to repent. And if they don't repent, then I'll destroy the city." Well, old Jonah hated the Ninevites. They were enemies to the children of Israel. And so what does he do? He doesn't pack up and head east. He books passage on a ship sailing west to Tarshish so he would be as far away from Nineveh as possible. See, he was disputing God, arguing with God, and resisting what God wanted him to do. This word gentleness means we act like Ananias in the 9th chapter of the book of Acts. Remember Ananias? Saul the Pharisee condoned the killing of Stephen, the first martyr. Is on the road to Damascus with letters from the high priest to bring back Jews who become followers of Jesus Christ and to have them tried. And on the road, the resurrected Lord appears to him and he's blinded and he's taken by his companions to a house in the street called Straight. And there was a man, a Christian in Damascus by the name of Ananias, and the Lord came to him and said, "Ananias." And Ananias said, "Here I am, Lord." There he found a man named Saul, who was blind. And he was to lay his hands upon him and heal him and tell him this message, that he was now God, the Lord Jesus' chosen vessel to be the proclaimer of the gospel to the Jew and Gentile alike. So Ananias, without disputing, without resisting, he goes to the street called Straight, enters into the room, says, "Brother Paul," lays his hands upon him, and reads things like, "Scales fell from his eyes, he regained his sight, then he is baptized, and he becomes Paul the Apostle." So that is what gentleness means. It means that we do what God wishes us to do without complaint. And that however he deals with us, we consider it to be good. And we carry it out. So that's the first aim of the Christian life, is to seek the highest bag. Second is to fight the good fight. In verse 12, fighting the good fight for the faith. Verse 12, fight the good fight of faith, take hold of an eternal life to which you were called, and about which you made a good confession in the presence of many witnesses. So, the second aim in the life of a Christian is to fight the good fight of faith. To not let society run over us. To not let society intimidate us from proclaiming the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. To not allow the enemies of the church to overcome us by being timid and shy. When it comes to proclaiming the gospel, we are to rely on the power of the Holy Spirit engage in a contest. It means to give every bit of its strength in that contest. It's because, you see, this word actually comes from wrestling and boxing in the Greek games. It's not talking about track and field. It's not talking about running races or throwing a javelin or a discus or broad jumping or whatever. It's talking about wrestling and boxing. And the reason you would contend with every bit of your ability that you would persevere is because in the wrestling matches in ancient Greece, the loser would have his eyes gouged out. So you really had motivation to do everything you could to win. If you lost, you spent your life as a blind man, hoping people would have you out. The word take hold means to seize upon something, to take possession of it, to lay hold of it. So he's saying to take hold of that gift of eternal life, to realize that it's true, it's a reality, it is your promise, it's been sealed by the blood of Jesus Christ, and no matter how difficult things may be, that can never be taken away from you. So you seize on that, and you seize them, and come to the cross of Jesus Christ, which is the instrument of your salvation. Then he says, you made a good confession. The word confession means to say the same as someone else or to agree with them. That is what we're doing when we recite the words of the apostles and Nicene creeds. We are agreeing with or saying the same thing that Christians have said since the 4th century. Since before there was any denominations, before there was any separation of the church between East and West, it was just the one church. And they would meet in councils to decide things. So by the 300s, we had the Nicene and Apostles' Creed. And we use them as a confession of our faith. What are the words that say before we do the creeds or the worship system? It says, with the whole church, let us confess our faith. So with the whole church, we're saying we believe that God is the Father and the Creator of the world. We're saying that we believe that Jesus Christ was born of the Virgin Mary, that he was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. And on the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, sits to come and judge the living and the dead. And we believe in the Holy Spirit. And we believe in the universal church. That is the Catholic Church, meaning little c Catholic, meaning all Christians and all denominations. And we believe in the resurrection of the body and life everlasting. So that is a confession that we make. We make it each week, agreeing with those who've gone before us and agreeing with Christians all around the world, celebrating the Lord's Day today. So the second aim of life for the Christian is to fight the good fight of faith. So that we can say with St. Paul, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. And then hear the Lord Jesus say to us, well done, good and faithful servant. And that brings us to the third aim of life, the last aim, and that is to keep the command of our Lord Jesus Christ and God our Father. Verse 14, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. That word keep means more to watch something or to observe it. It means actually to guard it, to protect it, to preserve it. The command of our Lord Jesus Christ is that we preserve, guard, and protect the gospel, the good news, and that we share it with others, that we reach the unchurched, that we go to every nation, to every country, to every village, to every hamlet, to every town, to every mountaintop and to every valley, to every desert and to every jungle, to every island, to every isthmus, to go to every nation and every corner of the world, proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. And then it means that we are, as I mentioned before, to love God. irreproachable, that it is free from vice, and that it is unsullied. There's no dirt. There's nothing that you can change about. It is the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So that is the third aim of the Christian life. Yes, we want to have a roof over our heads. Yes, we want to have food on the table. Yes, we want to have the best job we can obtain. Yes, we want to have as much education as we can obtain. But we don't make that the sole aim of our life. We don't make that our ultimate concern. But instead, we seek that highest value. We fight that good fight for the faith. And we keep the command of our Lord Jesus Christ. By doing that, then we are living life as God intended. And everything else then will fall into place. If God is first, many blessings flow. But when God is ignored, many problems happen. So let us always keep the true aim in life before us. Let us always remember that it is our relationship with God through Jesus Christ that is the most important activity we can do on earth. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We want to ask him just a closer walk with me, hymn number 697, in the back of the worship. Hymn number 697, just a closer walk with me.
St. John's Lutheran Church is singing a North American traditional spiritual, Just a Closer Walk with Thee.
start at page 105 in the front of your worship book. The words of the Apostles' Creed. And again, I invite those who can do so without difficulty to listen. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
This is September the 25th, 2016, St. John's Lutheran Church. You see the acolyte bringing the offering plates forward. We will now receive our offering that we are giving to God today. Flowers today are given to the glory of God, presented by Becky Dimitrov in memory of her father, Russ Mitten's birthday, and also by St. John's Choir in loving memory of Russ Mitten's birthday, who just sung Just a Closer Walk with Thee. Russ Mitten had a close walk with God all through his life. And his flowers today are to commemorate his life, his birthday, and his loving memory. We have had the Apostles' Creed. We now have the offering today. This is the service of the Word. Next week, the service of Holy Communion. October ushers are Janet Hogue and Sharon Leach. We have announcement. YULETIDE Festival is September 17th, 18th, and 19th. Booth space is available. It's November the 17th, 18th, and 19th, YULETIDE Festival. We're taking applications for vendors to set up a gym for our festival. Booth spaces are available with two chairs and charge of $50. Additional tables, if available, $5 each. The success of our festival depends on you. We have an announcement for Youth News. There's a youth event for Sunday, October 2nd, roller skating and pizza. The charge for the skating and pizza will be covered. Gary and Jan Dabe will be the chaperones. You'll meet in the Lowry Street parking lot after the 10:30 a.m. service. Provide your own transportation to the USA Skating Center across from the mall. Call the church office or Gary or Jan Dabe 240-0472 for the Youth News, the youth event. Christmas services this year on Christmas Eve, December 24th.
With confidence in God's saving grace, let us pray for the church and for all God's creation in need. Our response today is, Lord, hear our prayer. For those who are poor, homeless, or rejected, that we may overcome our fears and minister to their needs, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For all servant leaders in your church, that they may guide us in righteousness, gentleness, and love in all that we do together, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For all those in need of comfort, that God's touch will soothe them and bring them peace, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For this community, that we can recognize how you have blessed us, and thereby reach out in love to others, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. Together with all your saints who have fought the good fight of faith, we look forward to that day when we too shall rest in God's arms. We pray, Lord, hear our prayer. Hear these and all our prayers, O God, in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us
our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep you, now and forever. Amen. You may now be seated.
Watching St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. Come at 8 o'clock, come at 9:15 for Sunday school, come at 10:30 for the worship service. We're listening to the praise band singing now. Praise to God. This is the 25th of September, the 19th Sunday after Pentecost. Tune in anytime on YouTube for having bring you this service. We offer a Christian school program, which we hope will start again in January, but it's suspended because we don't have an administrator. Tune in. Lord's Day. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you and keep you this day and all your days. We'll pray for you. Continue to pray for us and for our YouTube ministry. You see our altar. We have the service of the Word. Next week we have the service of Holy Communion. Jesus Christ offers his body and blood to us on the altar. We become part of him. He is with us for all time, for all eternity. He offers us.